We have an economic crisis coming. The question is, how painful will it be? Because we have five different factors coming together at the same time. I'm going to go over what these five factors are. But the first thing that you need to understand is what pushes a little economic slowdown into an economic crash. Every crash, whether we're talking about a real estate crash or an economic crash or a stock market crash, has the same triggering factor. So when you have a crash, you have some sort of correction, some sort of market pull down, but then you also have typically high levels of debt, which triggered the correction into a crash. Let me show you what I mean. Let's assume now that home prices correct by 10%, meaning home prices fall 10%. Now, typically, that wouldn't seem like that big of a deal. Okay, home prices fall 10%, who cares? Well, if people have a lot of debt on their homes and they don't have any equity, that means that now people would be underwater. And if people don't want to continue making payments on their homes because now they're underwater because they have so much debt, then that could push this home price correction to a crash because it could signal a tidal wave of foreclosures. Like right now, the average home buyer is buying a home with about 6% down, meaning they have 6% equity in their homes. Then if home prices correct by 10%, well, you have a little correction plus a lot of debt. And now if people no longer have the ability to make their mortgage payments, or if they don't want to continue making their mortgage payments because they feel like they're underwater, they feel like they're not going to be able to get out, well, that can push this little correction into a crash. This crash can then become a financial crisis when you increase the amount of dollars that are involved. Meaning, now when you have a bunch of institutions, when you get Wall Street and the banks involved, and they start to see their assets crash, this then becomes a financial crisis, which can then trickle through the pretty much entire financial economic system. So if we continue on with the real estate example that I gave you just a minute ago, well, over the last number of years, we have seen a number of big institutions on Wall Street start buying up homes across America. How have they been buying up these homes? Because it's not like they've only been using the billions of dollars in their checking accounts. They've been using debt. So you have these big institutions, these big investment firms that had these large stock portfolios that then leveraged their stock portfolios, meaning they went into debt based off of the value of the stock portfolios, and they used this new debt to then go out and buy real estate. They bought homes across America. Now, if home prices fall or if stock prices fall, the bank might say, well, your assets have fallen. The value of your investments have fallen, so we want some of our money back. The banks might say, give us our margin call or collateral call, give us some of our money back. And this could then force the banks, these institutions, these investment firms holding on to the real estate to then start liquidating their real estate because their underlying investment value has gone down. So now when you start involving a whole lot more dollars, that could cause much more liquidations, more panic selling, more fear selling, which then pulls the markets even lower. And this is what then trigger a financial crisis. Now, I know this might seem a little scary and a little obscure, but the first thing that you have to understand is that this also creates a lot of opportunities. I'll show you how to capitalize on these opportunities in this video. But let me explain this a little more with a real life example, not just a hypothetical. In the United Kingdom, you had these big pension funds and these big institutions that would buy gilts with their investment money. Gilts were their version of treasury bonds. They are government bonds, government debt. This was known as some of the most safest investments that you could invest your money in. So they would invest money that people invest in these pension funds into these treasury bonds, the gilts, and then the gilt would then pay the pension funds interest. Now the pension funds would get this money in interest and then pay it off to their pension holders with now your annual or monthly interest payments from the pension. Well, what had happened was around the 2020 pandemic, the UK, just like the United States, cut interest rates, meaning the interest rate that these pension funds were getting from gilts became much smaller. They got whatever interest payments they were getting now slashed in half, so it was a much smaller amount. Well, they had to pay out these pensions, and so they needed more money. So now what the pension funds did was, like many other institutions, they went to the bank, and then they borrowed money from the bank based off of the value of their investment fund. And they took this new money and used it to buy more of these gilts, these essentially treasury bonds. That way now you're getting double the interest. Now, these small interest payments combined were enough to continue making their interest payments because you could borrow money super cheap and everything was good. But then the UK, kind of like the United States, in 2022 saw interest rates start to rise because their central bank wanted to fight inflation, just like how the Federal Reserve Bank is working to fight inflation. As their central bank worked to fight inflation and interest rates rose, well, it hurt the value of this underlying investment because now the pound started to drop. People were worried about inflation in the United Kingdom. They started to sell their bonds, and now the value of this investment started to go down. And that's when now the bank went to the pension fund and they said, your underlying investment, this, is starting to go down, so we need some money. We need some reassurance. And so now you have people selling out of their bonds, you have people selling out of the gilt. These pension funds are now running out of money because the banks are saying that they need money. And so now these pension funds also started to sell their investments in the gilt, which then created a bond crisis in the United Kingdom. This is late September, early October 2022. And now you have the pound plummeting, you have their bond market plummeting, and that was when they were on the brink of a complete financial crisis because these pension funds were on the verge of insolvency. They were about to go bankrupt because they didn't have the money to pay the bank, they didn't have the money to pay their pension holders, and they weren't getting enough interest from here. And that was when the central bank over there, the Bank of England, came out and they started buying these gilts. They started an unlimited bond buying program to save these institutions. That way now the underlying value of their investment started to go up. That way then they could continue making payments to the bondholders, and that way the banks would get off of their shoulders. Now, does this fix the underlying problem? No, but it kind of patches the wound for a little while, and this is how you create that financial crisis that I was talking about. So you have to understand, when you have a correction plus a lot of debt, that's how you create a crash, and this crash can then become a financial crisis based off of how many dollars are actually invested and involved in that underlying investment. Now that you can understand what would turn a correction into a crash, into a financial crisis, let's talk about what's happening here in the United States right now, because we have five different factors coming together. Factor number one is this record amount of debt, not just national debt, but also consumer debt and business debt coming together at the same time. Two, we're still facing extremely high inflation. Third, we're also seeing a slowdown in asset prices and our economy. Fourth, we're seeing our dollar strengthen relative to other currencies and how that affects us here in the United States. And then fifth, we have the global economic slowdown. So let me start by talking about number one, with the record amount of debt that we have here, not just in the United States, but also in the world. Our economy is fueled by spending. If you have $10 and you put this $10 in your pocket and do nothing with it, it doesn't stimulate the economy. But if you took that same $10 and then you went to Chipotle and you spent this $10 on a Chipotle bowl plus some extra guac, if you can buy extra guac with $10 now, well, now this $10 is stimulating Chipotle because Chipotle just made some money and they can use this new money that they made to hire more employees, to open a new location, and to grow their business. And so our economy runs on spending, but there's two different types of money that you can spend. You can spend actual money that you've earned, or you can spend debt. We live in a credit-based system, which means that in our economy, in our society, you have the ability to spend not based off of what you just earn through your money, but based off of how much money you qualify for through the help of debt, through the help of lines of credit, through the help of loans. This credit-based system has its own pros and cons, because now if you work a job and you make, say, $50,000 a year, and we didn't have this credit-based system, that means that the maximum money that you could spend in a year is $50,000, assuming this is after taxes, and assuming now that you're okay having no money left in your savings, no money to invest. So the maximum spending ability that you have is $50,000. This is the max that you could stimulate the economy. This is the max that you can buy. This is the max stuff that you could get. But if you live in a credit-based system, now you can earn $50,000 a year, but you might be able to qualify for another, say, $30,000 worth of debt, lines of credit, loans. Now all of a sudden, your spending power has gone up from $50,000 to $80,000. This means now you can buy more stuff right now. You can go on more vacations. You can eat at nicer restaurants. You can buy a better car. You can buy more clothes. You have the ability to spend more money, which means now from the economic standpoint that the economy can grow quicker. Because remember, our economy is fueled by spending. The more money you spend, the more money somebody else makes. If you have the ability to spend more money, because $80,000 is more than $50,000, now our economy can grow quicker and it can grow bigger. But this also has the drawback where it also creates booms and busts. These types of economic and asset booms and busts are a byproduct of our credit-based economy. And the way that it works is, well, the economy starts to grow. People are able to borrow more money because now you're making more money. People have more jobs. You're able to qualify for more money. So people spend more money. This then helps stimulate and grow the economy even more. And this keeps going on where people spend more money. The businesses earn more money. The economy grows more. People get hired more. People make more money, which means people qualify for more money. So you create this positive cycle until ultimately you reach a breaking point where now you have too much debt. People have spent so much money that now you are working hard not to buy more stuff, but just to pay down all the debts that you have. This is something that has happened for centuries. This is something that is just human nature. People spend too much money. People get greedy. Businesses get greedy. Businesses spend too much money. And this is where now you need a correction, where now you're spending more money to pay down your debt instead of actually buying more stuff. Now, instead of going to Chipotle to buy extra guac, you're eating at home. That way you can pay back your credit card debt for all the extra guac that you ate. And this creates a period of contraction, where now the economy is slowing because people are spending less money. People are spending less money because they're using all of their money to pay down their debts, to kind of get their finances back in order. This creates an economic slowdown. And this is where now you see this correction. Now remember, this correction can turn into a crash depending on how much debt you have. If you have a lot of debt, Chipotle has so much debt that they were relying on everybody to come in and buy the extra guac, and people stop doing that. Now Chipotle is not making any money because they don't have enough money to pay back their debt. This is where the bankers start knocking on the door at Chipotle and they say, hey, we need our money back. And they then start forcing Chipotle to start closing their stores. This is where now you can see a crash happen depending on the amount of debt out there. Well, right now we're at a time where spending is very high. People are spending a lot of money. You see a lot of economic reports talking about how spending is strong. Consumers are spending more money, which shows to some people that our economy is growing. However, there is a little bit of a caveat with this news that spending is growing because we also have super high inflation. I'm going to talk about this in point number two. And so what you see, if you dig a little bit deeper into these spending reports, is yes, people are spending more dollars, but they're getting less stuff. The reason why they're getting less stuff is because they're spending more dollars to buy the things that they want because the price of things have gone up so much. So it's not that people are spending more money to get more discretionary items to buy more things. They're just spending more money because you need more dollars to buy your rent, your groceries, your gas, and the fewer things that you want. So spending is up, yes, but it's not because people are buying more things. It's because the price of things have gone up so much. So that means people are spending more and more of their income in order to survive, while at the same time, we also have record amounts of debt. First, if we look at the national debt, our United States national debt has passed $31 trillion for the first time ever. Then if we go a little bit smaller, if you look at businesses and corporations have the most amount of debt ever. They just broke a new record high in corporate debt. Then if we look at households, regular people, well, people and households have the most amount of household debt ever. We're breaking new records with credit card debt and new spending debt. Why? Because people have to spend more money in order to buy things in this high inflationary time. And on top of that, we also have a record amount of global debt. I'll talk more about the global economy a little bit later in this video. You definitely want to make sure you watch this video until the end because everything I say is going to build on top of one another. But now we're facing a situation where our country has a record amount of debt. Corporations have a record amount of debt. People have record amounts of debt. And the interest rate on this debt is now growing very rapidly. Our interest rates that you have to pay on your debt today are at the highest levels that we have seen in over a decade now. But if you look at the interest rates we're paying today over the last 50 or 60 years, historically, they're still pretty low. Like if you wanted to get a mortgage back in the early 1980s, you weren't paying 5, 6, or 7%. You were paying 15, 16, 17, even 18.5% if you wanted to get a mortgage back in the early 1980s. So historically, our interest rates today are still relatively low, but if you look at just the last decade and a half, now it looks like interest rates are very high. Why? Well, after the 2008 crash, interest rates were cut to pretty much zero, and we left interest rates near zero since the 2008 crash until now. Yes, the Federal Reserve Bank did raise interest rates slightly prior to 2019, but after 2019, before the pandemic even happened, the Federal Reserve Bank started cutting interest rates to stimulate the economy. So that means that for the last decade, decade and a half, we have had people, businesses, and our country extremely reliant on cheap and essentially free money, meaning the easy access to capital, meaning access to cheap debt. And this has allowed us to build up this record debt levels where people, corporations, and the country have borrowed an insane amount of money because it was cheap and easy to access. Now, in order to combat inflation, the Federal Reserve Bank is being forced to raise interest rates aggressively. Like mortgage rates in 2022 have doubled from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. In fact, it's more than doubled in less than 1 year. And so this means now the cost of servicing this debt is going to skyrocket and has already begun to skyrocket significantly. So now, if you are a person and you have a lot of credit card debt, which is variable interest rate debt, meaning it's not a fixed rate debt like your 30-year fixed rate mortgage, your interest rate changes depending on what interest rates are. Now the cost of paying off your credit cards is going to get more expensive, even if you don't increase your credit card balance, because the cost of paying off this debt is going up. If you're a corporation, but now many times you don't have a fixed rate 30-year mortgage, you have 5-year, maybe 10-year loans, sometimes 1-year loans, which re-amortize depending on what interest rates are. So as interest rates go up, your cost of servicing this debt goes up. If you're now the United States government, your cost to pay down these debts have also gone up significantly. Janet Yellen, our Treasury Secretary, back in 2020 and 2021, was questioned about the national debt and how high it is. And what she said then, back in 2021, was that you don't need to worry about the national debt because our cost to service the national debt isn't very high. Why? Because interest rates were at rock bottom. We were seeing the lowest interest rates ever in 2021. Well, here we are today in the end of 2022, and now our national debt is significantly higher at more than $31 trillion, and the cost of servicing this national debt is more than double what it was back in 2021. So that means now the United States government is going to have to spend more of their tax dollars not to provide services to its citizens, but to just pay off its national debt. And this is at a time that we're already facing such high inflation. Now, all these things have a price. When people have to spend more money to pay down their debt, when businesses have to pay more money, now you have less money to invest in growth, right? Like if you have to pay more money to pay down your credit card debt, well, that means you're gonna have less money to spend at Chipotle. You're gonna have less money to go to Lululemon. You're gonna have less money to spend at Amazon. That means these businesses and the economy hurt. If you're a corporation and you have to pay more money to service your debt, well, that means now you're gonna have less money to invest in hiring more employees or even continuing to keep the employees that you have. And you're going to see more and more businesses cut costs, aka fire employees, in order to make up for the higher expenses. This brings me now to number two, which is the inflation issue that we have going on. Now, of course, if you do want to stay up to date on what's happening in the top finance and business news when it happens, the best thing for you to do is to read the actual data, read the actual reports. I'm not talking about headlines that the mainstream media covers. I'm talking about reading the actual press releases, reading the actual data, reading the actual reports. Now, if you don't want to spend the time or if you're not interested in doing that because they can be very confusing, then the next best thing would be for you to subscribe to something like Market Briefs, which is a free financial newsletter that I created where every day. My team is breaking down what's happening in the stock market, the real estate market, the crypto market, inflation in the economy, and the global economy into a fun, easy to read and witty newsletter. Even if you don't have any sort of financial background, I promise you are going to love reading Market Briefs because we make it so fun and so easy to read. So if you want to stay up to date on what's happening, if you're an investor and you want to know what's happening in the world or with your money, then you need to join Market Briefs. And the best part is that it's completely free. So if you want to join Market Briefs, I got the link to how you can do it down in the description below. Inflation comes from the word inflate. And when you have inflation, you are inflating the monetary supply, aka you are increasing the amount of dollars out there. How do you increase the amount of dollars out there? Well, you can print this money. The Federal Reserve Bank can literally print more money, or you can cut interest rates, which encourages more borrowing, which encourages more dollars to be created and spent, because banks will then have to get this money from somewhere that they lend out, and they get this money from the Federal Reserve Bank, who has to print this money. So now, when we have a lot of inflation, that causes the value of the dollar to go down, causing the price of things to go up. And in the past, what happens anytime you see one of these economic slowdowns is the Federal Reserve Bank will come out and they will start stimulating. They will start inflating as a way to grow the economy. So you see the economy start to slow down, people start to lose their jobs, businesses start to struggle, stocks start to crash, real estate prices start to come down. And that's when the Federal Reserve Bank will work with the government to start stimulating. They will start creating inflation. They will start printing money. Maybe they'll send out stimulus checks. Maybe they'll do some sort of bailout. They will do some sort of thing where the government and the Fed will spend money that they don't have in order to stimulate and inflate the economy. We saw this happen in huge form in the 2020 pandemic when the government and the Federal Reserve Bank printed trillions and trillions of dollars to stimulate and grow and stabilize our economy. We saw it happen in the 2008 crash when the Federal Reserve Bank and the government did quantitative easing. They sent out stimulus checks. We saw it happen after the 2000.com crash where the Federal Reserve Bank slashed interest rates. And we saw a number of different government spending proposals passed to help stimulate and inflate the economy. Now today, we're seeing the price of all the stimulus that has happened in the past, where now we're paying the price through high inflation. Now this poses a little bit of a conundrum, because the Federal Reserve Bank is playing this balancing act, where on one hand, they want to bring inflation down. And on the other hand, they don't want to induce a depression or even a recession. And the problem is, in order to bring inflation down, one of the most effective tools is to raise interest rates. Because when you raise interest rates, you make borrowing money more expensive and it pulls money out of the economy. But the consequence of higher interest rates is it hurts the economy. Higher interest rates make it more expensive to buy a home. Higher interest rates make it harder to keep operating your business. Higher interest rates make it less attractive for you to spend money because it costs you more money to spend. Remember the credit-based system that I told you about earlier? Well, now the credit side, the money that you have to borrow, is more expensive, so it's less attractive for people to actually spend money. And what we've been seeing happen over the last number of months is that now as interest rates have gone up, not only is it more expensive to buy a home, but that hurts the housing market. Because now when people can't afford to buy a home, they buy less homes, and now the housing market is slowing. Not only is it more expensive for businesses to borrow money, but now businesses are slowing because they have to now service their debts, and borrowing more money is more expensive. And so these rising interest rates hurt our economy, but inflation is still extremely high. And this is where now we're facing a tough situation, because we are on the verge of a recession already, if we're not already in a recession. And this is where now the Federal Reserve Bank is going to have to make a choice. Do we continue to fight inflation, or do we ease the fight in inflation and do we prevent a deep recession or maybe even a depression? Now, as of today, the time of me recording this video, the Federal Reserve Bank is saying that we're willing to do whatever it takes to bring inflation down, because if we don't bring inflation down, then we could face a potential currency crisis in the future, and that is much more painful than facing a recession or even a deep recession today. So the Federal Reserve Bank is holding strong on this idea that they're going to do whatever it takes to bring inflation down. Will they stay true with what they're saying today? I don't know. We'll see what they actually do, but as of today, they're saying that they're going to continue raising interest rates, they're going to continue to pull cash out of the economy, which hurts the economy, in order to fight inflation. Well, the difficulty now is, what happens then in this cycle? Because in the past, what has happened is anytime we start to go down here, you would see the Fed come in and inflate the economy to get the economy moving. You saw it happen in 2020, and 2008, and 2000, even in previous crashes, it was the same thing where you saw interest rates get cut as a way to stimulate. The economy would get hurt, the Fed starts cutting interest rates, maybe they start printing money. Now it's cheaper for you to borrow money, it's cheaper for you to go out and spend, so people start spending again, because now you can spend cheaply, and this helps stimulate the economy and get it moving. But you can't do that now, because you can't fight inflation and stimulate an economy at the same time. You gotta pick one. And this is where now the Federal Reserve Bank is hoping that the first thing to break is not gonna be the economy, it's not going to be the housing market, it's not going to be the stock market, but that it will be inflation. Because as you raise interest rates, you're hoping to bring inflation down. Well, as of today, yes, our economy is starting to struggle. Our real estate market is starting to struggle. Our stock market is hurting. However, the inflation is still very high. And the Fed is hoping that by raising interest rates, they're going to be able to break inflation, bring inflation down without breaking the economy, without breaking the housing market, without breaking the stock market. But will they be able to do that? Well, only time will tell. And this is where now you got to understand, if we do go into a deep recession and inflation is still high, then the Federal Reserve Bank might pivot. They might say, okay, inflation has come down off its highs, but now we're going to pivot. We're going to now start cutting interest rates. We're going to now start stimulating. We're going to start buying back bonds, like what you saw happen in the United Kingdom. There's just one domino that needs to fall that could flip the Fed's plan. And if that domino falls and then the Fed starts to change their mind and now they start stimulating, well now, yeah, you'll cause the economy to boom in the short term, but then inflation starts to get worse. Because right now we are facing an inflation-induced recession. Meaning, we're facing a recession because the cost of things have gone up so high that it's hurting people's ability to spend. Remember, our economy is fueled by spending. And if people can't spend because the cost of things are so high, well, that means you have to really fight the underlying problem, which is inflation. And if you keep trying to treat the symptoms, which is a slowing recession, that's going to make the underlying problem, which is inflation, even worse, which means that the bubble gets inflated even more. This is where you have to understand that eventually we're going to have to pay the price. That means economic pain. That means we're going to see a real estate market slow down in prices. That means stock prices are going to get hurt. Asset prices will have to get hurt as a byproduct of this fight on inflation. And this is where the Federal Reserve Bank is working to hopefully bring inflation down without creating a huge depression, without creating a huge stock market crash, without creating a real estate crash. But this is where you also have to understand what is the difference between a correction and a crash and a financial crisis. A correction is just when asset prices fall a little bit. No big deal. But that correction can turn into a crash if you have a lot of debt. Well, the average down payment on a mortgage right now is 6%. You have a lot of people that have a lot of debt in the stock market. You have a lot of corporations with debt. You have a lot of businesses with debt. You have a lot of households with debt. And so now if the economy starts to slow down and the debt is higher than the value of these assets, that's what can then take this correction and turn it into a crash. And now that Wall Street has all these dollars invested into so many different asset classes, that's what could then trigger a potential financial crisis, because now you have all these dollars invested into things like real estate and stocks and all these other assets, which are all triggered by the same dominoes. And this is where you want to pay attention to how inflation is going to affect our economy, because while the Federal Reserve Bank and the government keep saying that inflation is under control, it's going to be coming down, it's nothing for you to worry about, the reality is that bringing inflation down comes with pain. And if we don't pay that price today to bring inflation down, we're going to pay the price in the future, and it's going to cost us even more in the future to bring inflation down. This brings me to number three. We have our asset markets and the economy slowing down. Now, one of the symptoms of fighting inflation, the side effects, is that people will lose their jobs. The Federal Reserve Bank has said very openly that they want to cool the labor market. Cooling the labor market means that people will lose their jobs. Businesses will have to fire people as a way to show that this fight on inflation is working. If people lose their jobs, if wages go down, that means people are going to have less money to put into asset markets. People will have less money to buy homes. People will have less money to put into stocks. All these things will hurt the asset prices. And remember what I talked about in the beginning of this video, how debt affects how deep the crash will be. Well, right now we have record amounts of debt, not just in real estate, but also stocks. And so if people continue to lose their jobs, if the economy continues to slow down, well, now you're gonna have debt levels way up here and income levels down here. Because the thing that you have to remember about high levels of debt is that debt isn't a problem until it becomes a problem. Like if somebody has $1 million worth of debt, it's not a big deal if they can service the debt. It becomes a problem when they lose their job. And now you have to figure out how are you gonna pay off this $1 million worth of debt. And so high levels of debt isn't a problem until it becomes a problem. And right now, the problem isn't a problem. We have high levels of debt, but people still have the ability to service the debt. Corporations still have the ability to service their debt. Real estate investors still have the ability to service their debt. But if our economy continues to slow in the direction that it is right now, because we are seeing our economy slow down, this is a fact. If our economy continues to slow, businesses continue to see smaller profits, you're going to see more and more people lose their jobs. If more and more people lose their jobs, you're going to have less and less people who have the ability not just to spend, but also invest. If people have less ability to invest, that means asset prices, stocks, real estate, crypto, businesses, all these things start to see their valuations go down. Now, when you have the valuations of these assets go down relative to their debt, this is where you start to see problems. Because when your valuation is lower than the amount of debt that you have, now you're underwater. This is where the banks then start to knock on the door and they say, hey, you got to pay up. You're underwater. We need some money. And this is where now that correction can turn into a crash. Yeah, we've seen stock prices get hurt. We've seen real estate prices slow down. But this could turn into a crash if we start to see more dominoes fall. What would those dominoes be? Well, something like a corporation, big company, or a banking institution, or something large, which is unexpected, that now gets overburdened by the amount of debt that they have. They can no longer service their debt, and then they're forced to shut their doors unexpectedly, declare bankruptcy unexpectedly, get a bailout unexpectedly, and that could then trigger asset prices to fall even more. Now, this is where the Federal Reserve Bank will have to continue making their decision. What do they want to do? Continue focusing on the inflation fight and say, screw you, we're not going to bail you out? Or are they going to say, you know what, we're going to switch gears a little bit and we're going to do a little bit more inflation? That's what we saw the United Kingdom do. As soon as their bond market started to fall and the pension funds were on the verge of collapse, their Bank of England, their central bank, our version of the Federal Reserve Bank, then started to stimulate and create more inflation at a time where they were already facing record high inflation. So this is one thing that you want to pay attention to, because right now this is okay. Yes, asset prices have fallen. Yeah, the economy is slowing. But if we start to see this continue to go down this direction at a time when you have such high debt, that's where this economic slowdown could trigger a bigger asset crash. For example, in the beginning of this video, I talked about how institutions were leveraging their stock market portfolios to go out and buy more real estate. Well, just recently, BlackRock, which is a major institution which is involved in some real estate investments, has come out and said that they no longer want to buy any stocks. They have shunned stocks because they are worried about the future of this asset class, because they're worried about how this will affect this. Now, they own a lot of real estate. Their real estate is leveraged in part due to the value of their stock portfolio. And now you can start to see how debt comes in contact with asset prices, how it could trigger more dominoes if one begins to fall. Fourth, this one's interesting because the dollar has been strengthening. And this might sound like good news, and it is for some people, but it also has some negative consequences right now, strangely. So the good news is when you have a strong dollar and you go to a different country, like you go to Canada, you go to Europe, you go to India, you go to Mexico, you can buy more stuff with your dollar because your currency, the dollar, is stronger relative to other currencies. So when we import things from other countries, it's better for us here because we can buy it with a stronger dollar, meaning we need less of our dollars to buy things from somewhere else. However, when we send things from the United States to somewhere else, that's not good news to have a strong dollar. Because now when we create a product here, and you send it to China, you send it to India, you send it to Europe, you send it to Canada, they're going to need more of their currency in order to buy our stuff. So now people in other countries who are also facing an economic slowdown like us are going to need more of their dollars in order to buy something from us. That's not good news from them because they're not going to be able to buy as much stuff from us. But it's also not good news from the United States perspective, because that means businesses selling things internationally are going to be able to sell less stuff because people just naturally can't afford it. So you have the price of things growing here in the United States because we have high inflation. But in addition to things already being more expensive based off of dollars, people would need more of their currency in Europe and Canada and China to buy their things from us. And so it's very difficult for these other countries to buy things from the United States, which is hurting our company's profits. Now, in general, for regular people, a strong dollar is good news because that means you can buy more things with the dollars that you have. However, a strong dollar also comes with a little bit of a warning, because what happens if countries and currencies around the world start to lose faith in the dollar? The reason why the dollar has been becoming so strong recently is because you have all these countries around the world worried about a global economic slowdown, worried about this global inflation, worried about all these issues happening in the world. And so they've been looking for a safe haven. And the safe haven that they've come to is the world reserve currency, which is the dollar. So you have countries from around the world, and you have all these institutions and big investors that have been moving their money to dollars as a hopefully safe place to keep their money to protect it against inflation. But if inflation continues to stay high in the United States, and people become more worried about an economic recession, or they get more worried about a deep recession, or they get more worried about inflation staying high in the United States, that could get people to lose faith in the dollar. That could get people to want to move their money away from the dollar into something else, whether it's gold, whether it's real estate, whether it's cryptocurrency, and that could cause the value of the dollar to drop, which would then hurt people even more. And this is where you have to understand that just because the dollar is on top today, just because it's so strong today, doesn't mean it's going to stay like this forever. And this is where, you know, we have to be kind of worried and cautious about what happened in the UK and wondering if something like that could happen here as well. Because in the UK, people got worried about the pound, which is why they started selling their government's bonds. And that's what caused all the issues over there. And if we were to see something like that happen here, where people started to lose value and faith in the dollar, and they started to sell out of our treasury bonds, we could see a lot of issues happen here in our economy and our bond market as well. And so you definitely want to pay attention to this, because while a strong dollar today can hurt corporate profits in the short term, a weaker dollar could hurt people in the long term. And this brings me to number five, the global economic slowdown that we're facing, because we have countries around the world that are drowning in debt. We're seeing the global economy start to slow. China's economy is hurting. The UK economy is hurting. We have so many countries in Europe that are hurting. We have the Canadian economy, the real estate market hurting. So you have a lot of different countries around the world that are hurting. On top of that, you have the Russian war in Ukraine. And all these things have a price, not just because that means that these countries have less ability to buy things from the United States, which it does, but also that means that it could put more pressure on the United States to help support and give money to other countries. All these things now have an effect here, because if people and countries in other parts of the world are not buying things from the United States, that means companies here are making less money. If the United States then feels obligated to support and provide more aid to other countries that are struggling, that means the United States has to spend more money that it doesn't have to help support other countries. That means now our companies are making less money while inflation is continuing to go up because the government continues to help aid other parts of the world. All these things have an impact here in the United States because we live in a globalized economy where now it's not just what happens within the walls of a country. Different parts of the world can trigger recessions in other parts of the world. And we're seeing many other parts of the world slow down significantly faster than ours. And this is where you want to pay attention to what's happening in the world, because it could foreshadow what could potentially happen here in the United States. And what we know for sure is that we have many countries in Europe. We have China that are struggling pretty bad, and this could kind of give us an idea of what could potentially happen in the United States. Now, what does this mean for you? You want to be the one that's looking for opportunity, because recessions and market crashes create more millionaires than any other time. But it requires you to be financially educated. It requires you to be prepared. Financially educated, meaning knowing what to look for, meaning knowing what to buy, and being prepared, meaning having access to capital to actually buy these assets. Because when you have these recessions and crashes, people get scared. You see the prices of assets go on sale, and this is where you want to be able to come in and buy. So you want to be using this time to start putting aside money. Earn more money, spend less money, that way you have a bigger buffer, that we have some extra cash to take advantage of opportunities that might come your way, but also continue to learn. Market Briefs is a free resource that I created where you can stay up to date on what's happening in the world. I got the link for you if you want to learn more about that down in the description below, but also being aware of what's happening and how to invest your money. I have a ton of videos on my channel. If you haven't subscribed to Minority Mindset yet, make sure you do that. They go over how to actually invest your money, that way you know how to do your research, that way you know what to invest in. That way you can make smart decisions with your money, because the reality is that 10 years from now, people are going to look back at this time and some people will have used this, whatever is coming, as an opportunity to become incredibly wealthy, while others will lose everything. I want you to be one of the people that becomes wealthy because of what's happening, not one of the people that loses everything in spite of what's happening. And this is where you want to be financially educated, and this is where you want to be prepared. This was when mortgage rates hit 6%. So everybody who had an adjustable rate mortgage was able to get a very low teaser rate on their mortgage. and then it started expiring in 2007. And then in 2008, that was when we saw a huge influx of new foreclosures. And that was because now mortgage rates had jumped up